working title, who I've worked with many times before, sent me the screenplay by Anthony McCarten, and I laughed a lot. The script, surprisingly, given its title, Darkest Hour, is actually very, very funny. So I laughed, and then I cried. And I was quite surprised by that reaction. So I called up Eric Fellner and I said, you know, this is really, really good. But I'm not sure that I'd go and see a movie about Churchill. And Eric and I talked a little bit more about it. And he said, well, what about Gary Oldman? And as soon as Gary's name came up, I knew that I'd go and see that movie. And therefore, I had to make it. Gary's, you know, been a hero of mine since I was about 15, since he played Sid Vicious in Sid and Nancy. And the idea of a career that goes from Sid Vicious to Winston Churchill seemed like too tantalizing, really. So I went and met Gary, and I think we were both kind of a bit nervous of meeting each other, really. I was certainly nervous of meeting Gary, and I was surprised to find that Gary was kind of nervous of meeting me. And we went outside and vaped together. And by the end of that vape, we were like brothers, really. Brothers. That was it. We are in uncertain times, and there's a lot of anxiety about, and justifiable fear. But in the journeying around America and Canada and at home in the UK, I see an amazing level of resistance and protest. And I think I actually that fills me with great hope and optimism. I think it's extraordinary. And I think that Churchill resisted. He kicked and he screamed when it wasn't particularly fashionable. And so that level of resistance, I think, is an extraordinary testament to the man. You know, we now know that he was right. But at the time, you know, you didn't know whether he was right or not, you know. And so that I find hugely impressive and optimistic and hopeful. It had only been 24 years since the end of the First World War. And every family had been touched by that atrocity, really. And so we all, you know, were desperately trying to protect our children by not having them sent off to another war. So it wasn't, you know, so in a way there is a little bit of, well, Hitler's over there and, you know, we're here and we have this channel around us and we're going to be fine because we're, you know, Britain is a nice moderate country. And so Churchill was the guy who stood up and said, we need to resist this. Gary knew of a prosthetics guy called Kazuhiro, who lived in a warehouse. Is he actually agoraphobic? He might be. He never seems to leave. And he lives in a warehouse in downtown Los Angeles and makes these incredible sculptures. And so we went and saw the master, Kazuhiro, and very quickly... it became apparent that Kazuhiro was going to be able to transform Gary as was required. There was a lot of, I mean, you know, Gary prepared for the role for many, many months, and so there was a lot of trial and error with Kazu, and the most important thing was to make sure that we didn't, you know, end up with something that looked very much like Winston but was impossible to act through. So it was finding the right balance between Gary and Winston, really. But somehow there are certain actors who are like magicians, you know, they're shapeshifters. And somehow by sheer triumph of the imagination, they are able to transform themselves and make you believe that they are that character. And that's an incredibly powerful imagination. It's slightly weird, and a form of kind of a dark art, possibly. But they're able to do it. They're able to make you see things that aren't really there. And Gary is one such wizard. When I first sent the script to Kristen, she said no. She didn't want to do that. And I said, okay, can I come and see you in Paris and just have a cup of tea with you? No vaping. Tea with Kristen. You have to judge, careful, you know, judge the actor.
Choose your weapon.
Yeah, and so I went over to Paris to meet her, and I explained to Kristen what an important and wonderful role this was and how she should really play the role, and it was going to be amazing and fabulous, and she was going to be extraordinary, and I was going to really, you know, give her a lot of attention, which is often what an actor requires. And then there was a moment where she looked kind of dreamily off and said, you know, Clemmy had very good ankles. Like that. And I knew that's I had her. Do you know what I mean? I had her then. And I knew if she's starting to obsess about the ankles, I had her. And funnily enough, the ankles were a recurring theme throughout the process of the movie. Gary was all about the prosthetics. Kristen was all about the ankles.
Yeah, that's the sort of actress I am.
I think they're going to discover that he used humour as a defence mechanism. And that, as Gary was saying, people think of him as being this kind of gruff character, but actually he was incredibly funny, and that there was a kind of a sparkle constantly behind his eyes. And that got him through stuff, you know, and the importance of humour. And I think that might surprise people when they come and see the movie.